Stop it.
What?
Stop with the camera. Go outside and find something for your film.
I tried everything. I'm clueless. I need something with passion, you know?
Well, think faster. They'll make you drop the film major.
I know, I know. How's your animation project coming?
Okay, I guess. I'll have something, at least.
Nice. Coming right along.
Thanks.
Hello? Hi, Mom. You're kidding today? I know it's the 10th, you did tell me. I'm just under so much pressure to finish. I know it's Bubby, but... Okay. Okay, I'll be there, all right? No, I'm sorry. Okay. Love you, bye.
And what was that about?
My grandmother passed away 11 months ago. They unveiled a gravestone today. It's like a Jewish ritual or something. I loved my Bubby and all, but the timing is just the worst. Bye.
Hey, forgetting something?
At a cemetery?
You're the one who said inspiration could happen any place. Anytime.
Terrific. The one time someone's actually listening to me. Bye.
Moishe shalom b'mreima. Hu yasei shalom aleinu. V'al kol amo Yisroel v'yimru. Amen. Oh, my beautiful little Fagelin. Fagelin!
Hi, Fagelin. Oh, Fagelin. Your grandma would have been so proud to see you. I'm glad you came.
Sadie, those are Hasidim, right?
Yes, the late Yehupitzer Rebbe is buried there, who happened to be your Bubby's cousin.
The Yehupa who? You mean to say we're related to those guys?
That's a long story. Tell your old Zayda what's going on with his favorite granddaughter.
Only granddaughter.
Right.
But seriously, Zadie, you have to tell me more about those guys. They might be perfect for my film project.
You really want to know?
Yes.
Sit down. I will tell you, but remember, you asked. Now, to understand the Hasidim, we must go back in time about 300 years to the early 1700s. The place was the very southern part of Poland, called Volhynia and Podolia, near the Dniester River. It was the border with the Ottoman Empire. The Polish Jews at that time, they had a hard life. Many were very poor. Some felt their leaders were too much focused on money and scholarship and did not care much about the masses of ordinary Jews. The yeshivas, they were like universities of Jewish learning. They were only open to the wealthy or the most brilliant students, and they usually married the daughters of the few affluent Jews. The poor people often turned to itinerant preachers and wandering mystics who helped encourage them and heal their sick. These mystical healers were very popular because they cared about ordinary Jews. They were as poor as the people they served. The people thought that the secret of their preaching and healing was their knowledge of the Kabbalah, the secret mystical tradition of the Jews passed down over hundreds of years.
Kabbalah? Isn't that what Madonna's always talking about?
That's another story. Now, where was I? These men were called Ba'al Shem, masters of the divine names. That was because their powers to inspire and heal, and maybe even perform miracles, were believed to come from their knowledge of the secret names of God, that could control the divine power. The most famous of these wandering mystics became Rabbi Yisroel ben Eliezer. He was known as the Ba'al Shem Tov. That name could mean master of the good name, but also the skilled master of divine names. You'll also hear him called by an acronym, the Besht. People saw how the Besht prayed and they knew he was a holy man. He prayed with so much fervor of fire that he would sometimes shake wildly or even do a somersault during the service. The Besht's followers believed that when he prayed, their master achieved a state called Devikus, attachment of his soul to God.
I don't get it. Didn't all Jews pray a lot? What's so special about the Besht praying?
You're right. Jews believe they're commanded to pray every day. But when they watched the Ba'al Shem Tov and his group, they learned how to pray. Oh, they didn't do it because they had to, but they become close to God. Well, the Besht and his students taught them that God wants every Jew, and you can really connect with God in prayer. It's not only scholars who can be close to God, as the rabbinic establishment sometimes seemed to think. Really, though, the movement started by the Besht with two movements. First was the popular movement of ordinary Jews who flocked to him. But besides these people, there were some great Torah scholars from the big yeshivas who came to study with him. They believed in his wisdom and his mission to bring up love of God to the poor and lowly Jews, as well as the rich and learned. To them, he taught special mystical ideas. The most influential of these students were Rebbe Dov Baer of Mezritch, known as the Great Maggid, Rebbe Nachman of Horodenke, Rebbe Menachem Mendel of Permerishlani, Rebbe Yankiv Yosef of Ponoye, who would later write down the teachings of the Ba'al Shem Tov. He also taught his son Zvi and his grandson Moishe Chaim Ephraim of Sudlikov. People call these followers Hasidim, pious ones.
It sounds like everyone would want to be a part of the Ba'al Shem Tov's thing, whatever you call it, group?
Or movement.
Movement, yeah. So did everyone join? How did they know about it if there was no TV or radio? From newspapers?
Not exactly. You see, these students of the Ba'al Shem Tov were rabbis. Now, every town with Jews needed at least one rabbi. It's not like now that a rabbi is just a religious figure. These rabbis ran their communities and taught students. So now students from the circle of the Besht went to different towns and taught the way of the Hasidim there. Then their students did the same. The Ba'al Shem Tov's main successor was Rebbe Dov Baer of Mezritch. He was a great and charismatic leader who established a base of Hasidic teaching in the town of Mezritch, but his students went all over Poland. There was Rebbe Levi Yitzchok of Berdichev. He was known for defending the Jews before God, even when they were not on their best behavior. Another famous student of the great Maggid was Rebbe Shneur Zalman of Layadi. His Hasidic views were a bit unusual. He put a bigger emphasis on Torah study and learning than many of the others. They called his system Chabad. His son Dov Baer moved to a little town of White Russia called Lubavitch. So their followers are called Lubavitcher Hasidim.
Was that normal? that being the head of one of these Hasidic groups?
Well, they call him a Rebbe or a Tzaddik.
Okay, so the Rebbe is always the son of the old Rebbe.
Not always, but often. You see, the position of a Rebbe I have a Hasidic group was usually hereditary.
Like a dynasty.
Exactly.
What if there were a bunch of sons?
Sons? It could get messy, and sometimes it still does. If one member follows one son, the other member follows another, it can make a split.
What about daughters? I haven't heard about women in this whole story.
In that, the Hasidim were very traditional. Just like everyone else at the time, the Jews, the Christians, the Muslims, women at that time were not given a very big role. Some scholars have tried to prove different, and they found a few historically prominent women among the Hasidim, but not too many.
Figures. I just can't believe these guys are still around.
Not only are they still around, here's a chusin I think you know. Hello, Rebzalman!
Reb Moishe, Rebzalman!
How are you? Oh, good, good.
Rebzalman, I was over here a few times for Friday night dinner. So, you're a chusin?
Absolutely. We're Lubavitcher Hasidim. The Lubavitcher Rebbe sent me and Sarah to this college and Lubavitcher Hasidim on colleges and communities around the world to come bring Judaism back to the Jews.
Now, Feige, let's see how long you were listening to your old Zaydit. His name is Zalman. Does that mean anything to you?
Okay. You told me about a Rabbi Schneer Zalman who was an early Hasidic leader. Are you named after him?
You got it right. I actually am named after Lubavitcher, the first Chabad Rebbe. And there were seven in the Chabad dynasty. And now I'm at Ohio State. Oh, it was nice to meet you both. Come by anytime. Sei gesund.
Reb Zalman on only on happy occasions.
You too. It was very good to see you. I'll see you again. Be well. Yeah.
My love to your family.
Thank you.
So did all the Jews there become Hasidim?
Oh, definitely not. They had very strong opponents, very strong.
Their ideas seem so good. What kind of problem could someone have with making every Jew feel close to God?
The Hasidim, they made some people feel very uncomfortable.
Yeah, they make me a little uncomfortable. That doesn't seem like a good reason to fight against the Besht.
That was a real danger at the time. The Hasidim, they scared rabbis for other reasons too. They pray differently than everybody else in a new mystical way. Their wild movements during prayer seemed odd and inappropriate to some Jews. They didn't always put Torah scholarship at the center of their values. They practiced some other Jewish rituals slightly different than others did.
I guess Jewish law was really important to people.
Oh, absolutely. And for the rabbis, any interference with tradition and Torah law was a dangerous threat. There was something else too. Sometimes the rabbis were a threat to the power and standing of other rabbis. If Jews flocked to the local rabbi, the other rabbi's authority went down. It didn't help matters that some rabbis held court as if they were kings, you know, and kept a high profile. Some rabbis were corrupt or too busy with politics to be good leaders.
It all seems so sad, Zadie. Aside from these few Hasidim still around, like Zalman, it's all, like, disappeared. All these big ideas and traditions and stuff.
Not at all, Fagele. The Hasidim had a huge effect on Jewish culture.
What do you mean? What kind of Jewish culture?
All kinds of Jewish culture. Take music, for example.
Jewish music? Like Shabbat songs, you mean?
Of course. Jews love music and singing, and a large part of that is the Hasidim. I start to get into it, you know. The Hasidim, they were the ones who taught that music and singing about God and the Torah is another way to achieve spirituality.
Do you mean like what the cantor sings on high holidays? That never seemed very spiritual to me.
Well, some people find the cantors uplifting. Look, there are many kinds of Jewish music. Look, do you have a computer with you?
Never go anywhere without it.
Come here. Come here, my dear Fagele. Try this number.
Moishe, how are you? Who's your friend?
I'm Paige, Moshe's granddaughter. Who are you?
That, my dear girl, is Nedara Carlebach, who is a Hasidic musician. Her father, Rabbi Shlomo Carlebach. My goodness, he wrote hundreds of Hasidic melodies.
Absolutely right. Hundreds of songs, even thousands. My house is always just filled with music and stories. And my father used to always say, when God created the world, he didn't speak, he sang it. And this music is everywhere, and sometimes we just can't hear it. I believe very strongly that music is what uplifts us and what makes the hard things seem a little sweeter when there's music involved. Sometimes when two people are speaking to each other, they can't hear the person saying. It's just some kind of cross-like noise. They're both talking. But if I sing and you sing, together we make harmony. And music is the way we're supposed to speak to each other. And together we can fix the whole world through song.
Shlomo Carlebach was the embodiment of that kind of movement of, I'm connected to it, I come from it, but the way I live is already not there anymore. I'm nishtahin nishtaher, right? I'm neither here nor there. I'm somewhere in the middle. I'm take in galut, I'm really in exile, which is a very important place to be in, to be walking in the desert. I think the best Hasidic music is written in the desert, Bamidbar, is written in between. Not home and not there yet. At that place of that kind of tension, that kind of yearning, the best stuff can be written. So anyone who's sure of themselves shouldn't write Hasidic music.
Tzama nafshi, tzama nafshi. Elohim lelechai, tzama nafshi lelohim lelechai, libi 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 uvsari yerananu lelechai, libi uvsari.
The songs are definitely heavily influenced by Hasidic thought, you know, and, you know, starting with the first record, Shake Off the Dust, I mean, I've got, at that time when I recorded it, I was in yeshiva. I was living in Crown Heights in a Hasidic neighborhood, and I'd been studying in the yeshiva, in the school, for a couple of years and living there and pretty fully immersed 100% in the culture and in the thought. I would be reading a text, let's say, for example, something maybe from the Tanya, you know, from the Alter Rebbe, who was a Hasidic Rebbe, the founder of the Chabad movement, you know, in the, I guess it would be the mid-1800s, early 1800s. So I'd be learning something from there, and a certain line, something would pop out at me, you know, in the text, and a, you know, an idea, you know, representing some idea, and I would develop a song around it. And my most recent record, Light, was developed by sort of comparing and contrasting some of the different Hasidic dynasties and Rebbes and their philosophies on God and this world and their ideologies. So One of the main things I did was I got into Reb Nachman from Breslov, the Breslov movement, Hasidic dynasty. And one of his things was he told stories, you know. He was giving Torah lessons always that were sort of with a lot of layering, a lot of Kabbalah, a lot of Jewish mysticism, and very kind of heavy philosophically, you know, stuff about the creation of this world, where this world comes from, what place in God this world is developed out of, you know. Ideas like the Tzimtzum, which is an idea of constriction, how God constricted his light in order to create this world. It seems to me, you know, people come and talk to me and they have been really inspired by the music, and that's what, you know, that's what it's all about, you know, is taking that inspiration like I took when I was, you know, growing up, and as I still do, from music, which is what music is, you know. Music is that sort of direct mainline sort of channel to the source.
I feel like the Hasidic movement believes very strongly that God is right there, and you just have to access him through, you know, either through quiet prayer in the forest or chanting with a large group of people. But I grew up believing that God was right there next to me, and believing in song and dance and community as a celebration of making God part of our lives.
Thank you, Nedara.
Yes, thank you. Goodbye. Wow. She is so great, and the music is great. What else did the Hasidim do to get spiritual?
Well, they told a lot of stories, especially stories about their Rebbes and the wonders they worked.
Can you tell me a Hasidic story? I want to get the idea.
Sure I can, but you have to follow along because, as they say, it is a story inside a story inside a story. Now let's see. Our tale begins in the Carpathian Mountains between Hungary and Romania 200 years ago.
Not Jews?
What do you care we are? This is no place for you.
It is the night of the Holy Sabbath, and you are betting on cards.
What we do is no business of yours. Who are you anyway, huh?
I am a wandering storyteller. I was called on to tell you a story.
Who called on you? Huh? Not us.
That is a small tribute to the evil one who dances behind you while you desecrate the Sabbath.
Who are you? It can only be...
Never mind. Here is a story. Above the stars
are the seven kingdoms of heaven, one above the other. Like seven castles. The story I will tell you is about the fifth heaven, where the music of the stars never ends, and there is neither day nor night. Endless streets full of houses stretch as far as the eye can see, some fully built, some half built, some just a foundation. But there are no architects, no workers, no masons. These homes are built in a different way. Each home has an owner, a human being down on earth. Most of the owners think only of their daily lives and their physical homes. But a few know they must build their home in heaven as well, for they will need to go there someday. When we do a good deed, a brick sets itself in place in our heavenly home. Another good deed, another brick. Our actions on earth are the only builders in the fifth heaven. Now, while there are no humans building homes in the fifth heaven, there are others, and they are not our friends.
Now, wait a minute. I thought Jews didn't believe in a devil or Satan.
Die Fragen kaschen auf am Eise.
What does that mean?
It's Yiddish. Did I mention to you that the Eastern European Jews spoke the Yiddish language? It means you can't ask questions about a story.
What do you mean I can't ask questions? How am I going to learn?
Oh, God forbid. I didn't mean you can't ask questions. The problem is that your question is a good one and would take us far away from the story.
Okay, fine.
What is this? Whose home is this? It cannot be. Ah. All is not lost. Perhaps this soul will still be mine. Stay here and tell me what happens.
Yes, sir. What can I bring you?
My good woman, I do not need anything from your paltry stock. I am the jeweler for the King of France. I'm in these parts looking for pearls and diamonds to buy for the crown jewels. Have you any to sell me?
No, not
even some earrings. I can see that. Your Jew husband is no doubt sitting with his books, rather than working to earn you a decent life. It could be different for you, you know. Look. Oh, you do want them, don't you? Pity. Well, no matter. Your children are lovely. Children, come, see what I have in my carriage. Come, my friend. Let me take you away from this miserable life. Why suffer? I have connections with the king. I will get you work that pays for the finer things in life. Your wife and children. They want those things so badly. Can't you see it? Yes. And don't worry at all about your house. It will be fine.
And so the storekeeper's life changed. He no longer had time for prayer and good deeds. Memories of the charity and devotion of his former life slowly faded.
Please, are you going to synagogue? Take me.
Yes, and of course, my greatest triumph.
What?
I have lost. I have lost the game. I must abdicate. One of you must take my position. I am done.
Chazak yishelach meshicheinu ויישיב את שביתנו ואז נשבות שבתנו עולם שכולו שבת.
The shopkeeper, he was our grandfather. Satan failed with him, but he trapped us with these cards! Is there any hope for us, Reddy?
It is never too late. Come. Let us go to the synagogue. It will be light soon.
So I completed my film project. My roommate Sally finished her animation project. We combined them and we both got an A. But more importantly, I learned about the heritage of the Jewish people and I bonded with my Zadie. This experience left me with a lot more questions I want to ask him.